Dean Swan, dear colleagues, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, it is, of course, an honor to be here. I don't need to emphasize that. And when I discussed with a friend, Co Scooter, how I should present this lecture, he said, make it personal. So after that introduction, and after these problems have been solved here, I can, thank you, I can start. Now the introduction has already been done, but since I have prepared it so nicely, I will... Okay, I'll do it again. So my name is Marian, which may come as a surprise because phenotypically I appear as a male. But I'm a Pole of origin, and there Marian is a very usual name, and my family comes from Bohemia. I'm kind of a Bohemian. So it was Horzinek originally, and I'm a Dutchman by choice. What you see here is the house where I live in winter. We usually don't have much snow, we have mostly rain. This is why I prefer this continent for vacations. So this is where what my biography is. I have a Polish birth certificate with a rubber stamp by the Nazis when I became a German by annexation when I was 3 years old. And then I lived in the German Democratic Republic, which is the communist part of, used to be the communist part of Germany. And then in the Federal Republic, and then Venezuela, and finally in the Netherlands. Now, this is so-called, well, kind of a physical history. Now, I graduated in veterinary medicine, but fortunately never did clinical practice, or rather a short stint there that made me choose companion animals also for my virus career. So I went into science immediately, into medical virology first. As a diagnostician, I did neutralization tests with poliovirus when the first vaccination campaign, poliovirus vaccination, was introduced into Germany. But at the time, virology was not that fashionable. It was actually a budding discipline. And when I tried to explain to somebody what is virology, then the most prestigious instrument that you can show is the electron microscope. Now, this is the instrument to the right. Get the picture? Yeah. But in the meanwhile, virology has gained quite some public appeal. As you know, there have been movies made, and I invited my staff and told them there are 24 mistakes in that movie. Please identify them. And I indeed identified 23 of them. But the professional evolution, I'm talking about evolution, so also a scientist evolves during his and her lifetime. So I started as a laboratory worker, pipetting my experiments together, and then I became a writer and speaker, so the oratory of the lab oratory followed. And in this prestigious hierarchy, you see Mr. Pythagoras. That's the one on the right. But in Utrecht, in my university, it all started with a disease, feline infectious peritonitis. When I was appointed at the age of 34 in 1971, I came to a department where the freezers were filled with acidic fluid of cats. So my predecessor had had identified a disease, very frequent at the time, and so he, that was feline infectious peritonitis, he stored these liquids, and I thought when I came, well, let's try to find out what it is all about. And FIP has never left me ever since. This condition is fatal in most cases where you see clinical symptoms, clinical signs. But its biology was so poorly understood because it is enigmatic in the sense that you have a sporadic condition, sporadic viral condition. You have no epidemic spread, so not like flu, for instance. And a sporadic fatal condition appears like a condition, contradiction in terms. And antibodies, which you can measure, are of no benefit. On the contrary, they are even a reason for a quicker disease progression and causing the early death phenomenon, which has been found in many other viral conditions, also in HIV. So here you see one of the pictures that has made it into the veterinary press, and that is came originally from the Feline Advisory Bureau in the United Kingdom. And what you see is an emaciated, a very meager cat with a thick belly, and that is where the acidic fluid resides. So the clinical signs, I suppose most of you want to become clinicians, so I thought, why don't I tell you a little bit about it? You have an extended abdomen, which you have seen in the previous picture. You have a fever, and you have this anorexia, the malaise, and in some cases, you have ocular symptoms, neurological symptoms, you have icterus. All these explainable by the pathologic lesions in these different parenchymas. And we have two forms. Pathologists like to categorize the forms, and so they talk about a wet form, which is a polyserositis with effusions, and a dry form with disseminated pyogranulomas. But of course, these distinctions are rather semantic than pathological, because in any wet form, you also have pyogranulomas, and there is always liquid in the body cavities when you have the dry form. Now, this is, as you will probably notice, not the abdominal cavity that contains the liquid, because there are ribs, and as far as I'm informed, this is a thoracic cavity. Yeah. So it is a polyserositis, which also shows, for instance, in the pericardial sac. And the diagnostic approach is, in most cases, to make a puncture into the abdomen. And then you will find a straw-colored liquid that coagulates readily. So this is just to give you a general impression. What you can see is the abdominal cavity filled with that liquid, and here the so-called mutton fat precipitate in the anterior eye chamber, which is a very frequent finding in feline infectious peritonitis. The pyogranulomas can be large, such as in the kidneys, that you can even palpate them. And they consist of a mixture of cells like granulocytes, but also decaying granulocytes, but also macrophages. And in the macrophages, and that is the that solves the mystery which I will explain you in detail later, the macrophages contain the virus that is actually fatal for the cat. It's a variant of an enteric virus that has changed in tropism and that has found the macrophage as its target cell. Now, in 1977, we took these liters and liters of acidic fluid and tried to purify, not to isolate, but to purify viral structures from that liquid. And we did this by gradient, sucrose gradient centrifugation techniques that are largely obsolete today. But at the time, it was the way to do it. And we were able to propagate a virus in suckling mouse brain. Now, you, from my biography, you have heard that I spent some time in South America and worked on arthropod-borne viruses. We heard about arthropod-borne viruses today already. And at the time, the method for isolation was injection into suckling mouse brain. Today, this is no longer done. But at the time, it was easy to go to the jungle, collect mosquitoes, have some litters of mice, and try to isolate. And paralysis in those cases is mostly the symptom that you use for suspecting that there is a virus growing in the brain. Now, the same procedure we applied to material from the acidic fluids, and indeed, we could propagate a virus that was identified as a coronavirus. Now, why coronavirus? Because when we took infected cells infected with a different coronavirus, namely transmissible gastroenteritis virus of swine, we could use the acidic fluid from the cats to stain the antigen in cells from pigs infected with transmissible gastroenteritis virus. So what you see here is a heterologous fluorescence, cytoplasmic fluorescence, as a proof of an antigenic relatedness between the virus in the cat and the well-known transmissible gastroenteritis virus of pigs. The result of this finding was threefold. We started to work on feline viruses, and this has not left me until today. I founded the European Society of Feline Medicine, and I'm running now the advisory board on cat diseases, which develops guidelines for the vaccination of cats. So, feline viruses. Then we focused on coronaviruses, which were quite unpopular at the time, because, mind you, that was the time before any human condition caused by coronaviruses had been identified. Now we know about SARS and about MERS, but at the time it was just the infectious bronchitis virus of chickens and the mouse hepatitis virus that had been studied before. So what you see here are false color electron micrographs. Actually, this is the original false color that I took from a newspaper article. They did a nice job. And then we became fascinated by viral evolution. Now, why evolution and why coronaviruses? Theodosius Dobzhansky, a Russian, Darwinian evolution biologist, formulated, nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. And the reason why I think coronaviruses are so interesting in terms of viral evolution is their size. The size, not of the virion, of the virus particle, but of the genome, of which you will hear more. Now, it leads to new diseases, and new we define as something hitherto unknown. Of course, each and every one of us does not know everything, so it may be personally new to you that you don't know a thing, but we talk about new to science. So when you look at the bulk of literature, it has not appeared that we call new. So in individual animals, the pathogenesis, in FIP, I will touch upon that, and in the field, epidemiology also is a showcase of viral evolution, like in the TGEV case. TGEV stands for transmissible gastroenteritis virus. Now, why coronaviruses? This is a portrait of these viruses. The problem is that even when you look at normal, say, fecal samples by electron microscopy, you see many structures that resemble these viruses, which are in most cases, the artifacts that you see are in most cases mitochondrial membranes, which also have these projections. But in coronaviruses, they are called peplomeres, and they are very important because they carry the determinants, the antigenic determinants for neutralization. So what are coronaviruses? They are enveloped, positive-stranded RNA viruses with the largest RNA viral genome known. Positive-strandedness in virus genomes means that the genomic RNA can be translated into proteins directly at the ribosome, that you don't need a translational step before. So we have negative-stranded viruses like influenza viruses that need to make a complementary copy before being able to make a protein. So the largest viral RNA implies the highest possibility or probability of making genetic mistakes. Imagine if you have a polynucleotide, which is a linear molecule, and if this is long, then with the stochastic principle of genetic mistakes, a long genome will have more mistakes as compared to a short genome. So this is just stoichiometry, which defines the probability of genetic mistakes. And in addition, RNA replicases don't have a proofreading mechanism in contrast to DNA replicating enzymes that can correct mistakes. The mutation frequencies in RNA viruses are between 10 to the minus third to the 10 to the minus fifth, which means in 10 to the minus fifth means one in 100,000 nucleotides can show a variation. And in coronaviruses, it's about 10 to the minus fourth. And if you have a genome that has just 30,000 nucleotides, then you will have no two genomes that are without a genetic mistake. The anatomy of the coronavirion is easily explained. You have the RNA that is here wrapped by a nucleoprotein, N protein, and that is surrounded by a lipoprotein membrane. And from this membrane, proteins stick out, like here what is that, pink? Well, we call it pink. These pink proteins, they are the S proteins, the spike proteins that carry the determinants and the antigenic determinants for neutralization and also for protection. Now the genome, this may be boring for you, but it is very interesting, I can assure you. The genome contains one-third about a polymerase gene, which comes in two reading frames. Then there are the structural proteins, the one that built the virion itself. That is, again, your S protein, the spike protein. There is a membrane and the nucleocapsid protein. And proteins that are non-structural, that are not part forming part of the virion particle. So the evolutionary behavior of coronaviruses can be viewed when you see that deletions, point mutations, recombinations, all kinds of genetic reshuffling leads to changes in tropism, like in transmissible gastroenteritis virus of swine. There was a deletion mutant which acquired a new ecological niche, namely the lung. It went from the gut to the lung. In FIP, as I will show you, it is from the enteric cellular milieu that the virus changes into macrophage tropism. In SARS, the severe acute respiratory system syndrome of humans, it is species jumping that the ecological niche that used to be the civet, it's not a cat. It's called civet cat, but it is not. It belongs zoologically to a different cluster. Anyway. To human, and we have now MERV, which is Middle East respiratory virus. Their species jumping has been found from bats, fruit bats in that case, to camels, to humans. We actually did a study with the successor to my chair, did a study on antibodies in dromedaries, in camels, and there were antibodies found by neutralization tests to MERV. So deletions, for instance, in transmissible gastroenteritis virus, when you look into the feces after an infection, you have the virus for a period of about 8 weeks after recovery from the diarrhea. But if you look into the lungs, you find it for more than 3 months. So there is virus persistence and a chance for mutation. And this indeed has occurred in 1984. A respiratory coronavirus was all of a sudden found in pigs in Belgium. The Belgium pig growers used TGE virus neutralization tests to assess whether the virus was absent from their stock. So for decennia, their pigs were antibody negative to TGE virus. And then in 1984, all of a sudden, the whole pig population seroconverted without enteric symptoms. So what was it? It was a virus that has caused seroconversion, but that had occupied a new ecological niche, namely the respiratory system. And the reason was a large deletion of 700 nucleotides about in the spike gene. But this, of course, this deletion did not delete the genomic information for the neutralization relevant epitopes, otherwise you wouldn't have had these antibodies. And the respiratory variant by now has displaced all the enteropathogenic parent viruses in all pig populations, as far as we know, thereby acting as a natural vaccine. So this is what you have seen in the porcine field, but as was said before, I'm more inclined to the carnivores, which are also admittedly the more intelligent animals, although it doesn't show here. We have coronaviruses in carnivores, like the canine coronavirus and the feline coronavirus, and it has been shown by molecular means that they recombine. So the canine and the feline virus meet each other in a doubly infected cell and exchange genetic information. And this is what we found already quite some time ago. When you have the canine coronavirus genome, you know the genetic disposition by now from the previous slides, and you see that here in blue, that in recombinants that you isolate from the field of a feline coronavirus type 2, there is part of the canine information integrated into a feline coronavirus background. And the fact that the crossover points are at different positions in different isolates means that this recombination occurs time and again. So it is not a laboratory artifact or something of a specialty of the Utrecht laboratory, but we can assume that as soon as you mix species, coronavirus recombinations can occur, and these recombinants can assume new properties. Let's get back to the feline enteric coronavirus. These infections in cats are very widespread, particularly in high-density cat populations. Now, it is well known that in contrast to the dog, the cat is not an animal that comes usually in groups. The cat is a solitary territorial predator, and if you put them into catteries, you're actually doing something that causes two things. It causes immune suppression by territorial stress, which means that the immune system is chronically suppressed, and it optimizes transmission of agents between the animals. So in catteries, you have a very high percentage of seropositive animals. In single cat households, it is less. But FIP is a very rare condition when you look at it from a statistical point of view. Only about 1 to 5% of the seropositive cats will eventually get FIP and will die from it. We did a study where we looked in litters and between litter mates how the distribution and how the phylogenetic tree of these viruses looks. Here you have one litter, and in this litter you have one feline enteric coronavirus kitten that survived, and you have two kittens that died. And you see how close this relationship is here. The same in another litter, feline enteric coronavirus, which is just a mild enteric infection, and FIPV, which is fatal, and so forth. So the close phylogenetic relationship between the enteric virus and the FIP was apparent, was evident from the very beginning. So what are then the peritonitis-causing coronaviruses? They are in vivo mutants occurring in individual persistently infected cats. So the persistent infection is in the gut, but then due to the expansion of the quasi-species cloud, which I will explain in a minute, you have the statistical probability of increased mutations, and under these mutants there are FIP-causing variants. The stress that these cats undergo can be a crowding stress, as I have told you, but also stress by another infection, like retrovirus infections, which notoriously suppress T-cell immunity. So when the cellular immunity is suppressed, then the mutations arise. And they arise stochastically, which I have already told you. The quasi-species principle was already mentioned today in a previous talk, and I thought I might entertain you by telling you a little bit more about it, because everybody talks about it and hardly anybody understands it, including myself. There was a Nobel Prize in chemistry given to Manfred Eigen, and he published a seminal paper to understand quasi-species. The paper was called Statistical Geometry in Sequence Space. And to explain it to you, I just reproduce one graph from his PNAS paper. Imagine again my polynucleotide that I showed you before. If you look at this polynucleotide and you take position one, so the first nucleotide here, and you want to depict it in kind of a diagram, then this one nucleotide, if it was just a 0-1 possibility, would have this representation as a line with a 0 and the 1 at its end. But of course, we have four different nucleotides. But to keep it simple for this thought model, we take it that there are only these alternatives. Now, this was in position 1. Now you go to the second position, into position 2. There again, the same may occur. But you compose that with the previous one, and you arrive at this quadrangle. In position 3, it would be a cube. In position 4, it would be a hypercube. And so you can expand the geometry. You cannot, of course, imagine how it is in reality. But as a mathematical model, this can be used. Now, if you look at this space, this hypothetical space, as the sequence space, you can see that a species like for instance a cat would occupy a point in that sequence space. So any larger deviation from a consensus sequence would be a non-cat. That would be something that is not existent, cannot live. Now imagine that you would have a replicating principle, a replicating molecule that has all the liberty to vary in every and any nucleotide. That would fill the entire sequence space. But this doesn't exist, of course, because there are restrictions. Not every sequence gives rise to an organism. So this is just for the sake of argument and for the sake of explaining quasi-species, and this is what viruses do. They replicate, they occupy sequence space, and in doing so, they expand their cloud. The cloud of variants, the cloud of mutants, is eventually occupying more and more of that sequence space. I'm explaining this in order to show you how we think that FIP variants occur. Because when a certain constellation is met, when a certain condition is fulfilled, in that case, the condition that the variant can multiply in the macrophage, then you would have an FIP variant, an FIP mutant. We were able to identify the mutation, and there are only two places where these mutations take place, in the spike gene of this coronavirus, but I will not bore you with the details. So that's, in a nutshell, my personal history of coronavirus evolution. There's more to it, but I thought I might conclude by giving the broader picture. So viruses have, of course, crossed the host species barrier time and again. And the Garden of Eden for virologists is a zoological garden where different species are housed next to each other, where virus transfer from one species to the other can occur, And I'm always surprised how little occurs in zoos. But time and again, we will find that viruses cause the so-called emerging diseases or re-emerging diseases, and they will do so forever. And interspecies transmission has, of course, gained quite stage and limelight in the case of SARS, of this coronavirus that came from the palm civet and was transmitted to man. We have that again with the Middle East respiratory syndrome of more recent appearance, and coronaviruses between bats change species all the time. Now, SARS was the first human killer coronavirus, and it was due to very efficient control at airports and at travel foci that it could be contained. But I recently lost a bet to my postdocs, with whom I regularly take bets on viruses, and I told them there would be another SARS outbreak within 5 years. Unfortunately, it came after 5 years and 2 months. So, so I lost my crate of champagne. The common palm civet was quickly identified at the time, and the CDC, the Communicable Diseases Center in the United States, issued not only warnings but also an embargo of civet transport across borders. This embargo is no longer in function. So what are viruses when they are evolving so quickly and so unpredictably? They have been referred to as the mistletoe on the tree of life. And exactly that is the case. They have co-evolved with the hosts, their respective hosts, and they continue to do so, only in time frames that are sometimes larger or broader than our observation periods. There have been random examinations done of ocean water. Craig Venter has done that. And the result was that every milliliter of ocean water contains 10 to the 7th virus particles. And a global was calculated of 10 to the 30 virions in the oceans. So if you line them up end to end, and viruses are very small, so lining them up is quite a challenge, I would think, they would stretch for 200 million light years into space. If you are good at calculation, you can control whether this is true. Let me close. I knew from my study as a student who Sir Arnold Theiler was. Actually, friends of mine in Switzerland also consider him one of theirs, whereas you consider him one of yours, don't you? But he is the father of veterinary science in South Africa, and after being a veterinarian, a clinician, he developed the first vaccine against rinderpest, which was eradicated very recently. And to my great surprise, the eradication of smallpox was center stage in all the literature, and it was published time and again, whereas the eradication of rinderpest, which gave rise to many veterinary faculties in Europe also, was quite inconspicuous. But we should, as vets, we should be proud that this has been achieved. He was, as you all know, of course, the first director of the Ondersteport Veterinary Research Institute and the first dean. And his son, Max Theiler, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1951, which you all know, of course. Probably it is also a question in your examination, isn't it? I would think so. For the development of a yellow fever vaccine, the 17D strain, which he developed. And now comes a discovery I made during preparation of this talk. He described the acute liver atrophy and parenchymal hepatitis in horses in these reports in 1918. And now, about a century later, some months ago, in the PNAS, the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, a group of these Indian guys here identified a previously undescribed divergent virus from the flaviviridae, also from yellow fever-related virus, in an outbreak of equine serum hepatitis. So it took about 100 years after Sir Arnold, not Sir at the time, I take it, described that condition before the etiology was really clarified. So son Max you see to the left and father Arnold, and this will be the last parsimonial tree that you see today. You see here the relationship between this Theiler disease associated virus of father Arnold and dengue virus, yellow fever virus, tick-borne encephalitis virus, and the different hepatitis viruses of man, also the non-primate hepatitis viruses. So apparently, flaviviruses run in the family. And I may conclude with a personal paraphrase: nothing in virology, makes sense except in the light of evolution, also of its history. Thank you very much.